A very blessed afternoon. Shalom. So good to see all of you here in the house of the Lord, where we encounter the Lord. I pray that we are ready, all ready to meet the Lord as a community. Let us stand and let us use today's appointed Psalm, Psalm 145, as a place where we align our hearts with the Lord. Amen. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all He has made.
All your works praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Your faithful people extol you.
They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might.
Let all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all He promises and faithful to all He does.
The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down.
The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. The Lord is righteous in all His ways and faithful in all He does.
The Lord is near to all who call on Him, to all who call on Him in truth.
Amen. He fulfills the desires of those who fear Him. He hears their cry and saves them.
The Lord watches over all who love Him, but all the wicked He will destroy.
My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise His holy name forever and ever. Together, glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Please remain standing.
Good evening, church. Last week, Reverend Kelvin reminded us in his sermon that we ought to draw near to the Lord, not just on Sunday service itself, but throughout the week. And as we seek to draw near to Him, the Lord promised that He will also draw near to us. And we can always come to the throne of grace with confidence because of what Christ has done for us at the cross. So let us sing this song of praise as a prayer from our hearts unto the Lord.
Your will unfolds in my life, living. Truly, Lord, by the power of your love, you give us strength and all that we need. Good afternoon, church. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this." Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us and write all these laws in our hearts. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all men. I invite you to sit or kneel as you can. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant us that we serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
The Lord uplifts all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. Father, all so often we fall and we are sorry. Now we stand before you bowed down. And know that you will lift us up, because Scripture assures us. Your Son Jesus died so that we may be lifted up. Let us receive God's gracious forgiveness. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Dear Pastor, do you have another song? You were just very early with your song, so what we'll do now is we stand together and pray the collect together. And it was a wonderful song, thank you. Let's pray together. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light that they may return to the way of righteousness. May we and all who have been admitted to the fellowship of Christ's religion reject those things which are contrary to our profession and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Please have your seats as Jan will bring us the first reading.
The scripture reading is taken from the book of Joel, chapter 2, reading verses 19 to 27. The Lord replied to them, "I am sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil. enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive the northern horde far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land. Its eastern ranks will drown in the Dead Sea, and its western ranks in the Mediterranean Sea. And its stench will go up, its smell will rise. Surely, he has done great things. Do not be afraid, land of Judah. Be glad and rejoice. Surely, the Lord has done great things. Do not be afraid, you wild animals, for the pastures in the wilderness are becoming green. The trees are bearing their fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the autumn rains because he is faithful. He sends you abundant showers, both autumn and spring rains as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. The great locust and the young locust, the other locusts and the locust swarm, my great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be shamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May invite us to stand as we listen to the gospel reading. The Holy Gospel is recorded by St. Mark, chapter 5, reading from verse 21. And all God's people say, glory to Christ our Savior. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, my little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and lived. So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet, instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his clothes, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? You see the people crowding against you? His disciples answered, and yet you can ask, who touched me? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ, our Lord. Please, would you take your seat? Our speaker today is the first Asian missionary to lead an Anglican diocese in South America. He and his wife, Michelle, spent 3 decades in Bolivia, landlocked country, becoming the longest-serving missionary. Let's put our hands together. Let's welcome Bishop Raphael.
Praise God. Thank you so much for that warm welcome. For me, it's always a joy to come back to St. Hilda's Church. Shall we? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Amen. Let us pray. Father, I pray for a mighty outpouring of your Holy Spirit. I pray that you stir us up to seek you afresh and to never see ourselves, oh God, as people lost without hope or vision of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. My theme today is on Christ as our restorer. I have my... We all need to be restored from our ignorance, and by His grace, He always gives us knowledge and insight into something that we may not have realized in the past. When I went to Latin America, people didn't quite know where Singapore was. And one day, Bishop Renis came, visited us. He spoke, and I translated for him in Spanish. And that was quite a scene to behold, you know. Two Tamils, one speaking in English and the other speaking in Spanish. And after the conference, someone said, oh, now I know that Indians are the majority in Singapore, you know. And I remember, you know, many years earlier, this was before Google, you know, again, when people didn't quite know where Singapore was. And I remember many years when people asked each other, this was an experiment. You know, I was the first Asian to serve within the Anglican Church, to serve within a particular diocese. And so it was something fresh and new, and people didn't quite know where Singapore was. I remember, you know, people asking, so where is Singapore? And, you know, someone would say, well, I think it's in India, you know, somewhere in India. And then someone would say, no, you don't know, it's actually in China, right? And, you know, it took me quite some time to explain to them that, no, we are on the tip of the archipelago, and that we're a sovereign nation. And then Google changed all that, you know. When people got to grips with Google, and then everyone knew where Singapore was, and everyone knew about our brand name, our reputation as supposedly a first world country. And so that was a real blessing. So it brings to focus, you know, what God is doing. You know, Asia and South America don't appear to be relevant to each other, but in the overall plan of God, we see in the book of Revelations of how the Lord will bring together the nations at the foot of His throne to worship Him. And it has been a real blessing on my part to be a part of the Lord's work, you know, as we see something of our heavenly glory in what we do in the here and the now. So I've seen God at work restoring consciousness of the Christian faith as something universal. I've seen Him doing marvelous things in the lives of people. And when let's see now if I can do this. Okay, here we go. When I talk about Bolivia and Singapore, the first question is, where is it? You know, it's right at the heart of Latin America, and the first reaction always is, wow, it's so far, you know, and it takes me about 2 days, you know, to return to Singapore. And this is my family, 1993, 30 years later, there we are, here I am with white hair, and my wife, who looks the same, she's a Peranakan girl, you know, by the way, highly recommended. If you want to get things done, and you want a strong lady, marry a Peranakan. Praise the Lord. And there she is with the creative arts, you know, and she's, that's her basic gifting, but she's now mentoring leaders and teaching and preaching in the church. This is the church this is the congregation that I used to pastor, Christ, Light of the World, Cristo Luz del Mundo. And when I was consecrated, you know, I still had a hand in the ministry of the church. I was located in this place. I was living in this place called Santa Cruz, which is actually a bit like Singapore, you know, a thriving city, a hub for economic growth and development. Also, sadly, a hub for the drug trade. Because Latin America, where you see plenty of money, you scratch the surface, you'll find the drug trade. Oh, we love to eat. Okay? Achai charu is a lot like mangosteens. And piranhas, we're landlocked. So we would eat fish from the Amazon River, you know. I remember when I was a young parish worker in a church, I asked my wife, you know, silently. She didn't know much about this sensation that I had about serving in Latin America. And I said, you know, dear, have you ever considered the Amazon River, South America? And she said, don't be crazy. You know, that's on the other side of the globe. So we had a number of, you know, funny conversations. And that's the steaks, highly recommended, juicy, thick, you know, nice red meat. I wouldn't recommend it if you've had an angioplasty like me. You know, I've cut down on all red meat, you know, and sugar and carbohydrates. Gosh, man, steaks, Latin America. We love to eat like Singaporeans, you know, and we share our lives through a meal. And people live for the moment. And that's something different from us in Singapore. We like to project, plan, think, and get worried about what's going to happen. But because I suppose we don't have much, we live and we appreciate the moments that we have. And I've learned that, you know. I've learned to appreciate the moments and to have these heavenly encounters with people. We pray for them and we talk to them. Huh? Children form the backbone of a lot of ministries. The majority of Bolivians, I think, are within what, the 13 to the 25 age range. And so it's a blessing to work with Bolivian children. I was consecrated bishop, and my predecessor is on my left, Frank Lyons, and on my right is the new bishop of Bolivia, Bishop Walter, a national Bolivian. And this is something that I really want to give thanks and praise to the Lord. And I really want to say this with loads of sincerity to the Diocese of Singapore, who supported me through your givings and through your monthly quotas. All right? Because it's through the givings of the local churches that I got my salary. And so I'm so full of gratitude for what the Lord has done through you for the work in Latin America. Within 30 years, the church is not... When I went in 1993, there was not one single Bolivian clergyman or pastor. But now, you know, 30 years later, you find, you know, the place is just full of Bolivian clergy, and now they've got their own bishops. So, you know, 30 years, I sense, you know, the Lord, I've seen him move and touch lives and restore families, and I'm so overwhelmed by the fact that Singapore Diocese, through Bishop Moses Day, made it all possible. Amen. Thank you so much, St. Hilda's Church. You may not know it, all right, but you are part of this tremendous project. Amen. I mean, you don't get to hear about it much in the synod and so on. It was, you know, I just want to share that with you. This young lady, Natalie, was ordained deacon. She was only 12. This is actually an example of the kind of restoration that we do, you know. A lot of the ministry in Bolivia goes to the nitty-gritty of people's problems and issues, all right? And now this might be a little, this might not resonate much with the Singapore church, all right? But I would say that about 60% of the people in our pews are in their second marriages, or maybe their third, you know. You find single mothers here and there. Now, you don't have that here, because we're all respectable Anglicans, right? And we know somehow how to cover up our failings. And what I've noticed there, however, is that it's part of the life to church. It's part of the of church life to talk about how you've messed up and how Jesus can come in and heal you and restore you in profound levels, you know. And this girl, she comes from a broken home. Her father left the family for another lady. And her mother was so struck by her daughter's enthusiasm for Christ when the daughter was 12 years old. So she came to the church. She sat at the end of the pew there. And she was just trying to figure out what was going on in the church. What was it that, you know, changed her daughter profoundly? And then within a couple of years, she also accepted Christ, and she's now in the parish church council, Ilsen. So this is the kind of work that we do, and this is what I want to share with the Singapore church. Christ restores, you know, on so many levels. And so this is the message I feel that the Singapore church needs to once again rediscover, believe it or not. Now, some of you, you know, wherever I go, people think like I'm some kind of a foreign talent. I'm not, you know. I'm a Singaporean. I was born here, went to a mission school, Cha Kway Teow, Hokkien Mee, Kway Teow Teng, I'm there for all, all right? So, as I went to Latin America, I would like to suggest that Singapore at its best, okay? At its best, okay? At its worst, let's not talk about that. I think we all know about its worst. But Singapore at its best comprises of generous, loving people who God wants to use to reach out to those who are broken and healing. Right? And you know, we don't have to go to Latin America to do this. It's right here, right? Next to your neighbor, your family, and even yourself. The Lord is here to restore us in profound ways. So as we look at the text, the gospel text, we want to look at several levels of restoration. And the first, this is Edgar, maybe we'll talk about him later, is how Jesus healed this lady who was suffering from a disease, a blood-related disease. In Mark chapter 5, you will see Jesus on his way to the home of Jairus. And Jairus is a well-known religious leader. And he goes and he meets up with Christ and he begs him to go to his house and to heal his daughter. But on the way, there's this lady, this anonymous lady, who stretches out a hand. And she touches the hem of his garment, and he and she is miraculously healed. All right, and so this is the first point that I want to make, that we find that restoration involves a degree of health, physical health. Jesus restores our physical health. And we have experienced some of this in our lives. We have seen God do amazing miracles to heal people. And we do not stop praying for people to be healed. Right? Now, perhaps the people that we pray for, we may not see an immediate healing, but we should not be discouraged. We should keep on praying for the sick. It's like evangelism. When you share the gospel with someone and if they don't receive Christ, it doesn't mean that you don't share the gospel anymore. We have to just keep on sharing the gospel like how we keep on praying for the sick. And you'll find that this healing that she received from Christ was quite profound. And we will deal with those levels. But what I want to underline here is something that perhaps we sometimes miss out on, you know. It says in verse 25, the end of verse 24, a large crowd followed and pressed around him, Jesus, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. She used up all her Medisave, all her CPF, and nothing came out of it. And she grew worse, the Bible says. And many of us, I think, I want to share this, okay? We are all declining physically and cognitively. Amen? No amen for that, okay? And for people in our generation, right, I think that's kind of scary to see yourself decline physically, you know. Right? And then when you see people passing away, that also affects us. And we ask ourselves, oh, where is God in this? You know what I mean? And we associate God exclusively with our decline, our physical decline, right? And we tell ourselves, I'm wasting away. My life has no meaning. This lady suffered for 12 years, you know, right? And she probably felt marginalized in those days, you know, when you're sick, it's like COVID, you know, you have to stay where you are, you can't come out, and, you know, you just multiply the psychological impact of COVID 20 times, and you'll figure out where this woman is at psychologically. But I want to get back to this idea of the years that we apparently lose as we suffer from physical and cognitive decline, as we age, right? Now, parallel to that, all the mistakes that we have made in the past, we have made mistakes in the past. Some of us are in our second marriages, right? And we tell ourselves, oh, my first marriage was a big mistake. Right? And then some of us are deeply hurt by our children, by what they do. And you say, I wasted my time. I should have spent more time with my son and my daughter. Right? I wasted my time. Right? And we begin to live with the satanic lie that somehow I've wasted all that was precious in me. And there is no way I can retrieve what I lost. A lot of people feel that in Singapore. But, you know, Singaporeans, we don't emotionally process what's going on, you know. I don't know. Right or not? You know, it's difficult for us because we are hardened and we think about, you know, trying to get this right, get that right, and we become quite desensitized, you know, to what's happening. And we just learn to live with that sense of having failed. Because it's scary, you know, to uncover it and to say, I messed up here with my kids, right? And perhaps this woman, 12 years, okay? She's sick, lost for 12 years. You know what the good news is? The good news is this, that in heaven, time is eternal. It's not chronologically measured like how we would do it. And Paul talks about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And I want to suggest that as the lady touched the helm of our Lord, and as she was beginning to receive this physical healing, she is also beginning to receive this eternal experience, which brings her to a place of a complete and total restoration. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. We have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. He's talking about a treasure. Something that's bigger and greater and grander than our cancer. Our cancer will plague us for a couple of years. But compared to the light of eternity, cancer is 30 seconds. That's why Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, he says, we do not lose heart. Yeah? Last year I had an angioplasty. Yeah, I have two stents. We do not lose heart. He's not talking about the physical heart. Right? He's not talking about that. He's talking about the motivation. Live fully for the day. Right? He says, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, that's the physical decline, right? Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, for what is unseen is eternal. I am not trying to diminish or underplay our physical suffering. Not at all. All right? But there is something really powerful in the scripture here that Paul is trying to communicate to us. That when we begin to walk with our Lord, we are experiencing a heavenly reality that far outweighs our physical and cognitive decline. And that's good news. And that's something that which this lady, I think, experienced when she touched the helm of our Lord. She was restored physically and also emotionally, and we'll come to that when we go to point four. But I want to impress upon you this, all right? The restoration, is the healing of our Lord is physical as well as emotional and eternal. He brings eternity into our daily experience. He restores that deep eternal consciousness in our lives to such an extent that, yes, I'm going through a hard time, but what is eternity outweighs what I'm experiencing. Number two, Christ restores personal dignity. All right? This lady, if you look at the text, it says, when she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. So she had this consciousness that she was not just free from her sickness, but she was also free from her suffering. She experienced the life of our Lord to such an extent that her 12 years suffering began to dissipate before the eternal presence of our Lord. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" You see the people crowding around you, his disciples answered, "And yet you ask who touched me?" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. The president had asked him, well, not the president, but someone really important had asked him to pray for her daughter, for his daughter, Jairus. But along the way, Jesus makes a choice to tell everyone, this person who touched my clothes is more important. And I want to finish what God has begun in the life of this lady. She has touched my garment. She has received healing from me. Power has come out from me. And I want to complete and restore her a sense of dignity. Because our Lord knew that being a sick person as she was, you know, sick people lose their dignity. Which is why, you know, you're not... Well, I went to a hospital once. Last week I went to see an old friend in the hospital, and you know, we were told that we should not and cannot take photos of people as they were recovering from their sicknesses. And one of the reasons was to protect, you know, the dignity of the person. And you'll find that one of the issues we face as we work with people in their last days and so on, is to preserve, according to the world, whatever dignity is left. Because according to the eyes of the world, Your dignity goes with you when you die. And that is why, you know, poets and playwrights, they see death as the end. But for us, who have touched the cloak of our Lord, we know that there's a higher dignity, a heavenly one, that which restores us profoundly. Yes, yes, I go through sickness, I go through this physical cognitive decline, but this dignity that comes from the life of Christ outweighs my pain. It heals my shame. You know, as you grow older in life, okay, some of the older issues, some of the previous issues in your family suddenly begin to surface, right? It affects our mood, it affects our decision, and it makes us angry, and we do not know why. And part of the reason I want to suggest is because something in the past which we have not resolved comes to the surface. That's why, you know, I believe passionately that as we pray for the sick, we should also include counseling, inner healing, to ensure that, you know, as we grow older, we are cleansed and we are released from our sins and our mistakes from the past. And as we draw boundaries between ourselves and people whom we love, you know, we can't control the behavior of people whom we love. And at the end of the day, we have to be responsible to the Lord, and that we should not be held hostage by other people who make our life difficult. I hope I am registering with all of you. There's a dignity, there's a heavenly dignity that comes from our Lord. And this lady experienced it, which is why our Lord stopped everybody, all right, and he intentionally received this lady. It says in verse 32, Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it, right? Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. I say that again. The woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." You know what I love about this text? There was no secretary to make an appointment for this lady. Jesus stopped everything. Time came to a stop. I would also use my holy imagination. Even the angels stopped worshiping, because the eternal Son of God has touched the life of someone insignificant like this lady. And that is something so powerful. There's a dignity that comes from the heart of God that will not come from your bank account, that will not come from your position and status in society, that will not come from human recognition. It will not come. It will come from the heart of God, pouring into your own broken heart, restoring what no man or woman can restore. What is your human achievement? We can't define ourselves in terms of that. We define ourselves in terms of what Jesus said to her in verse 34. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Isn't that amazing? It's tremendous. And everything came to a standstill so that he could reach out and touch this woman. And you know, the Lord wants to do that for us, all of us, because to a large extent, we are all like this woman, right? I mean, we know how to cover it up. We know how to, you know, put a bold front and say everything is fine, but everything is not fine. And this wonderful, as we partake of the Eucharist this afternoon, this evening, our Lord is here to restore you in ways that are beyond your understanding, which is why we come to point three. where it's a build up on points 1 and 2. Okay, there's something that only Christ can bring into this world. I am the way, the truth, and the light. That heavenly sensibility. She has sense. You know, she touched the helm of his garment, and she may have thought that he was some kind of a healer or a magician, but she touched the very heart of God. She experienced an outpouring of God's presence from heaven into her life, something that she never expected. You know, all of us, this might come as a big surprise to all of us, but we don't know everything in life, and God knows us more than we know ourselves. Right? Although we make a big front about us knowing, you know, we know ourselves, we know nothing about ourselves. And when God begins to move in our lives, right, what appears to be small and insignificant in his hands, he will enlarge and he will use it to bless you as you walk in his purposes. You know, when I first began to think about Latin America, it was a traumatic experience. Now, in hindsight, things make sense, okay? For some reason, that only, well, that I think God knows. I think God inspired my mother to give me a very Latin-sounding name, Raphael. No one in Singapore knew how to pronounce my name, Raphael. Okay, so I got confused with the raffia string and, you know, my school teachers made a mess of my name. I went to the Navy. They gave up. No, it's too complicated. We'll just call you by your surname, Sam. All right? So my name was just like no lakula, okay? And I used to ask myself, you know, when I was a young boy, why this? She wanted a name with the R, you see? So, you know, like Robert, Richard, you know, all these races and all these wonderful names. Raphael. But when I went to Latin America, Raphael is like Lee or a Tan, you see? You know what I mean? So what may appear to be insignificant and silly and an object of humiliation, God can use that to further his purposes. Amen? Amen. I remember, I'm just so caught up with this, right? Because I think the Lord wants to stir the Singapore church, you know, right? I remember the first mission conference of our diocese was held in some hotel. I think it was called Paramount Hotel. I think it's closed. But in those days, I think it was in the 80s, you know, or early 90s, late 80s, early 90s. And we had this first mission conference. And, you know, I was pastoring a church and I had lots of issues in my mind. I was, I think, also chairman of DYB and I had lots of issues in my mind. But as I was thinking and preparing for this mission conference, you know, the only sense, the only hint that I had about missions was South America. And so when I went to this mission conference, it was basically, you know, sharing reports about the deanery and South Africa. They're talking about South Africa and Cambodia and Thailand and all these areas. And South America did not figure at all. So I told the Lord, I said, look, if this is really from you, right? If this is really from you, you have to speak through Moses J. Because only bishops can approve clergy going on to do missions, you know. Okay, bishops normally want their clergy to suffer as parish priests. Huh? But the mission field, you know, that's for another kind of a person. So anyway, I told the Lord, if this is really from you, then, you know, you've got to speak through Moses J. And, you know, and so on and so forth. Well, the mission conference came to an end. No one said anything about South America. Moses J. kept very quiet. There's nothing, you know, about Latin America. And we were having the Eucharist. And, you know, he finished the Eucharist. And then he was going to give the final blessing, you know, all right? And then he said, he just stopped, you know. And he said, you know, we've received calls for help from so many parts, from many parts of the world, and even from South America, would you believe, we've received a call for help, you know. And that really stirred me up, you know, what is this really from the Lord? And, you know, it was about 11:30 at night, you know, 11:15. So I was seated at the last pew, you know, and I was just wondering when this thing would finish for me to go back home, you see. And I went back home with that sense of, is this really from the Lord? And I went back home to relax. I on the TV, and there was a documentary on Peru and Bolivia, you know. Amazing, huh? And in those days, Bolivia was part of the diocese of Peru. So these little things, and you know, the door finally opened about 4 years later, and you know, we received a call for help from the Bolivian church, and Bishop Moses was quite agreeable for me to go and serve in the diocese of Bolivia as a missionary. And no one knew how long this would take. You know, I thought, well, maybe might last for 3-4 years, and you know, I can come back after that. But then, you know, it just doubled and trebled, and it came to 30 years, and I spent all my life there, and you know, they made me their bishop, and so on and so forth. The point is this. All right. The point is this. When Jesus comes into our lives, supernatural heavenly restoration takes place. And what we may consider like the end of the world, you know, I'm facing this decline, I got no more money, I'm struggling with this and that. And as we go through all these difficulties, there is this sense of faith, the sense of the presence of our Lord in our lives, which we are going to experience in the Eucharist. And as we receive Him afresh, you know, to build up our faith, I want to encourage you to stretch out your hand, to touch the hem of His garment, and to know that He is with you, and that whatever happened in the past, in His hands, will be restored and healed, and today is the time when He wants to do it. We'll be here to pray for you all. So I leave the mechanics there to your pastor, but I so dearly want to pray for people who want to be prayed for. And you want something of, you want to be physically healed, you want to be restored. I don't want to know all the details. He knows. I pray, and things will happen. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Let us pray. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Lord, we ask that You would forgive us. Forgive us because we, Lord, are in a rut. We don't want You to amaze us anymore. We don't want You to be happy with us. And in fact, You are so happy with us. You like us. You want to be with us. And You will stop the crowd. And You will wait for us as we touch the hem of Your garment. Lord, we give You our physical bodies that are declining. We give You our cancers. We give You our stress. We give You our cysts. We give You our disease. Lord, we want to once again embrace heaven. We want to embrace heaven. We want to hear the angels sing, O God. We want to once again experience heaven on earth. Here we are, Lord, at Your banquet. Feed us with your life. Feed us, O God, as we eat Your body and Your blood, and revive, restore, and renew us, Lord. Hear our cry. We pray in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop Raphael. Let's appreciate Bishop again, you know, for bringing us God's word. Yeah. Right, let's kneel or sit here, as you can, if you can kneel. We enter into a time of intercession. Let's pray for the Diocese of Singapore, and also at this moment, pray for the Diocese of Bolivia. We pray for Bishop Titus Chung. We pray for the Bishop of Bolivia, Bishop Walter, as well as Bishop Raphael, their family and their teams, their ministry teams. Lord, that you will constantly protect this bishop, your servant, and grant them wisdom and strength as they and their team lead and shepherd your church throughout the world, especially be it in Singapore or Bolivia or anywhere else in the world. May the Anglican Diocese be blessed, and for those in need, and be united to Christ, that all who are called by his name have the fear of the Lord, and they will walk in his way and be ambassadors for Christ and be a beacon of hope. We lift up the parish of the weak, Chapel of Resurrection, COR, in prayer. May your wisdom, grace, strength, and anointing be upon the vicar, Reverend David Lee, and his team. May you, Sovereign Lord, bless the work of their hands as they tend to the spiritual needs of their members as they labor in their various ministry. We also remember our dear sister, Pastor Wendy Yong, as she disciples the young, and also may they grow, these young grow to be men and women after your heart, Lord. For the world, we pray for the conflict in Ukraine and the war will not escalate further, and we pray for the leaders of both Ukraine and Russia that they will hold peace talks soon, and Lord, they will come to a resolution and resolve to ending the war soon. We pray for your mercy, Sovereign Lord, over this increasingly dangerous and troubled world that we live in, the tense U.S.-China relationship, the uncertainty in the geopolitical situation, and the poor economic outlook. May you, Lord, grant peace and restore France as well, and end the riots due to the death of a 17-year-old who was shot by the police. For Singapore, we thank you, Lord, for your blessings and all the goodness that you bring to us, and for the people as well as the government of Singapore. May we as a united nation continue to be strengthened as our country re-image the social well-being and greater inclusivity and harmony among diverse groups of citizens. We pray and we continue to pray for your wisdom, Lord, upon our leaders in this nation, that they will navigate the challenging times, and also as we, as a small nation, Lord, prosper to be your beacon of hope. We also pray for our youth as the nation celebrates Youth Day on the 3rd of July. May our youth grow in confidence as unique individuals, discovering their gifts, and may they grow to their full potential. May you, Lord, help them to know you and to desire for a relationship with you, and may they grow to be men and women after your heart. For St. Hilda's Church, we pray our under-shepherds, Vicar Martin, Reverend Honan, Reverend Kelvin Wee, may you, Lord, watch over them and their families. May your anointing and wisdom, grace, strength be upon them as they shepherd the church and render pastoral care. May they be refreshed daily with your living water, and may they find rest in body, mind, and spirit. We also pray for our pastoral staff and administrative staff. Bless the works of their hands as they seek to be faithful in their respective works. As for our PCC, who will be gathering for a retreat on the 7th and 8th of July, Lord, we pray that your presence be with them as you speak with them, as they ponder and reflect to be ready for the retreat, that, Lord, as they wait upon you, Lord, in prayer and in worship, may you lead the retreat and direct them so that they can deliberate matters of the church with clear unity and sovereignty. So, Lord, we just pray that you will grant a fruitful meeting as they plan and you will direct. And may there be a good time of fellowship as well amongst the clergy, the PCC, and the pastoral staff as they get to know each other better. We also remember those who suffer in mind, body, and spirit, the lonely and the bereaved. May they experience God's healing and grace, and that his everlasting help in times of need. As for ourselves, Lord, during the sermon, I'm reminded of 2 Corinthians 4:8-9, that whatever situation and conditions of life that we may be faced with, Lord, that we are hard-pressed on every side, but we will not be crushed, perplexed, but will not be despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not be destroyed. So may we all stand victorious, and may your light shine out of the darkness in us, shine in our hearts, to give us the light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. So with your power and with your time, and in your time, we will be assured and be confident. We ask all this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let us indeed all stand together, because in Christ we can stand victoriously always. And let us celebrate that we are all standing in and on the rock of Christ. Let's say the words on the screen together. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please exchange a sign of peace with one another. With you, my dear brother. Bishop, that must be a custom in the Bolivian church. Yeah, we don't go around and... I was wondering if you do a whole round. Thank you so much, Bishop, for bringing us God's word. Of course, we know what the term Jehovah Rapha means, right? Rapha is where the name Raphael comes from. And I'm sure your mum didn't just want a name with an R. She knew the Lord who heals, and that's where your name comes from. Praise the Lord. I really thank you for your word, as we often say, your word in season. And as Bishop Raphael said earlier, he does invite all those who want to come forward to be prayed for after the end of the service. We will stay behind and we will pray for you if you would like to come forward. Just like the Lord called Bishop Raphael and eventually his wife Michelle to a place where they eat piranhas, which is a bit far-fetched for me, the Lord also called this church more than 20 years ago to a retired rubbish dump to start a copy stop in an HDB area a little bit down west in Kampung Arang. And this weekend is the weekend where we celebrate Lafkop Sunday. We will do that especially tomorrow at E2. So if you are an Angsa and if you would like to come back tomorrow again, that would be a great encouragement for the staff of Lafkop. Eileen Magnus will preach at E2. She is a founding board member of the work down there. And like what I said, a good number of the staff will be here, and we are inviting the staff afterwards. So the work there carries on to this very day. Many of you know the work well. Many of you have an Angsa polo shirt at home, but those of you who may not know the work so well, let me just briefly introduce you to the work. By now we have, we are occupying basically four void decks of two blocks there. One is an activity center, like a walk-in activity center for the elderly, and we focus specifically on those who are senior and lonely. We also bring a lot of care and love to their homes if they are no longer able to come to the center itself, but that's a place of games, a place of chit-chat and casual interactions with one another. And then we have two centers for dementia clients or patients. It's daycare, so they can they are usually brought in the morning and go home in the late afternoon. And I think at full capacity we have something like almost 60 people there. And then we also have a center for rehab, physical rehabilitation, both for the elderly but also for anybody who needs rehab, maybe after you have a fall or maybe after you have a surgery. And this is not just available for the people in Kampong Arang. It is a center where you can go yourself for rehab. When you have a doctor's prescription, we can receive you there and you can receive rehab. We have been working together with physiotherapists from Tan Tock Seng Hospital for the longest time. So it's a place where we provide employment for about 70 people, and they all care with the love of Christ. Not all of them are Christians, but all of them know that what we do is propelled by the love of Christ. And when we as Angsa go into the community, we do that usually for what we call trekking. So we go at certain times in the year where we invite the residents for particular events that we organize, and we give them gifts, and then we also build some relationships with those that we visit regularly. So that's our ministry as a church. It has been the ministry for more than 20 years, and as the Lord carries, we look forward to continue to engage our people in that ministry, even those who may have joined us just over the last few years and may not know the work that well. When the next opportunity to serve comes up, we will let you know. And I mean, serve comes up in the sense of like trekking or so. But almost every weekend, you will find in the bulletin a call for help in the Lefkoop community. So for example, this weekend on the almost last page, you see, and do not forget to do good and share with others, for which such sacrifices God is pleased. And there is an ask for help for to donate a two-door fridge, a single bed frame, mattress, pillow, etc. So all of these are opportunities to serve and to share the love of Christ and also share material blessings if you feel so inclined. And as we celebrate Lefkoop, we will all get a towel as we go out from here. I would like to thank you all for praying for us as we went on to a tour on the footsteps of Luther through Germany. Some of them are here in the hall, and I'm glad I see you all back safely. We had a wonderful time. The Lord was gracious unto us, protected all of us. Mind you, we had people in their 80s with us, and most of the walking was on cobblestones, so I was really blessed that people were very careful the way they walked, and we were able to bring all of them back safely, and we were blessed by the trip. Thank you for those who prayed. Next week, we will come to the end of our sermon series through the book of Exodus, and towards the end of the month, we will start a new sermon series. And that sermon series will be on the book of Revelation and will take us all the way through to November up to the season of Advent. If you are part of a cell group or if you would like to go deeper in your own studies, we have a little study book available in the office for the cell groups and also, I suppose, individuals that would like to make use of it. If that is you, then let the office know and we will make books available for you. Next Tuesday is our church prayer meeting. I think there's one slide for that. Wonderful, thank you. We gather once a month, usually up in Joshua Hall, but sometimes together with Marine Parade Christian Center, then we go over there. But this month, it's us alone in Joshua Hall on Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. It's a time of worship and a time of prayers. Do join and pray unto the Lord together. Also, in our nation, you will know that leading up to National Day, Love Singapore always organizes a 40-day prayer rally. And that prayer rally starts this coming week, I believe. More information you will find in the bulletin. If you need advice on that, let us know. And coming up in August, we are planning a family day for St. Hilda's. We will give you more information on that. Now, since we are starting a new month, yes, today is the 1st of July, we also have a new memory verse. Let's read it together as we do on the first weekend we just read. Let's do it together. The Israelites had done all the work just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Moses inspected the work and saw that they had done it just as the Lord had commanded. So Moses blessed them. Exodus chapter 39, verses 42 to 43. You get a sense of coming to a closure of the book of Exodus, but also a sense of how the Lord directs his people, and when they do it in accordance to his will, there are blessings in store for us. Praise the Lord. For those of you who are following us from home, we would like you to get up at home and say the grace to one another. If you have children with you, you may want to place your hand upon the children, and the grace will be on the slide for you.